I 100% agree with you in the assessment that this feels more sinister. This is starting to me to seem like it's not even left or right. It's not a political issue. This seems like an attack on American values, American traditions, and you're actually actively trying to make children aspire to things that are grotesque. This is not about diversity anymore, Tucker. It's about perversity. No. We are celebrating perversity in America.
To many fans and critics, one of hip-hop's defining features is its loose attitude towards sex. Whether it be in words or in deeds, this genre's sometimes blatant sensuality has been the source of both distaste and enjoyment. Although this aspect of the genre remains a problematic issue for some, the general public's attitudes towards this kind of music have been a lot more tolerant in the recent past. Just a few decades back, such kinds of music were actually deemed too obscene to be played or even performed in the public. One of the earliest groups at the forefront of challenging these attitudes was the 2 Live Crew. This group ended up gaining nationwide infamy for their flagrantly carnal brand of entertainment. Before Megan Thee Stallion, Nicki Minaj, and Cardi B could ever be accused of corrupting our youths, the 2 Live Crew were on the receiving end of an extraordinary amount of public scrutiny for the music they produced.
The latest chapter in a growing national debate over where, in a democratic society, art ends and obscenity begins, and who should decide.
Today, we are going to look at the story of the insane rise and eventual collapse of the 2 Live Crew. Miami in the 1960s was a melting pot of many cultures. There were Cubans, many of whom had come to Miami after Fidel Castro came to power in 1959. There were Jamaicans who had come partly due to a high demand for labor in certain sectors of the American economy, and partly because it had become too difficult to get to their preferred destination, Great Britain. There were also smaller amounts of people from other Caribbean and South American nations. All of these distinct cultures being mixed in one area made Miami a ripe environment for the innovation of new kinds of music, and it was in this culturally rich environment that Luther Campbell was born. The son of a Jamaican father and a mother with roots in the Bahamas, Luther Campbell grew up in a part of Miami called Liberty City. As he came of age, he rejected the Caribbean stereotype of having a more traditional career, which was in sharp contrast to his 4 older brothers.
What's his job?
He's a 4-year-old little boy. He doesn't have a job.
4 years old and doesn't have a job? Why, when I was your age, I had a paper route, a Kool-Aid stand. I mowed the lawn. I was a delivery boy, a babysitter. I worked in a coal mine all while I was simultaneously in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th grade. You better get a job before it's too late, boy.
One served 2 tours in Vietnam before becoming a clinical psychologist working with combat veterans that had PTSD. Another got a degree in chemical engineering and worked for Monsanto. Another became an executive chef, while another studied aerospace engineering and became a test pilot for the Navy. Ignoring this precedent, Luther dreamed of becoming a linebacker or a defensive end in the NFL. In the 11th grade, he got the ice-cold bucket of reality thrown in his face when his high school coach told him just how unlikely it was for him to strike lucky in the NFL. With that dream vaporized, he decided to pursue another dream, to become the best DJ in Miami. Around the mid-1970s, disco, a music genre focused heavily on getting people to dance, was huge in the United States, more so in Miami. Thanks to Miami's semi-tropical climate, outdoor partying was especially common, and DJs would set up at venues that included homes, parks, car washes, and even skating rinks. It is believed that the outdoor DJ cultural phenomenon could probably be traced back to the sound systems of Kingston, Jamaica. In Kingston, DJs would throw street parties by hooking up turntables and huge speakers to a generator that would be mounted on a truck. DJs could then charge admission fees or sell food and drinks at the parties that they hosted. The criteria that a lot of listeners used to judge a DJ was not harmonic complexity or profound lyrical content, but the size and power of a DJ sound system. Instead of going solo, many Miami DJs would team up and form DJing crews. Some of the big crews were the South Miami DJs, the Soul Survivor DJs, the International DJs, and the Jammers. After leaving high school, Luther joined a smaller crew called the Ghetto Style DJs under the stage name Luke Skywalker, or Uncle Luke, and played records with them while he worked as a cook and dishwasher at the Mount Sinai Medical Center. The Ghetto Style DJs were eager to have him. Since they were still small, they only had a measly pair of speakers to call their own. Luke helped build the group's arsenal by purchasing every 15-inch electro voice subwoofer his pockets allowed him to obtain. Unfortunately, as a cook, his pockets could only afford so much. In an effort to earn extra money, he began to think of other more unconventional strategies of making money. His choice? Selling drugs. As we approach the late 1970s, Miami Beach, a city close to mainland Miami, was an epicenter of excess and hedonism, which meant a large appetite for psychoactive substances. Why did this happen? Many factors, and I can only run through a few. First was the global oil shock of 1973, which produced what came to be known as the Dame Dos, which is Spanish for Give Me Two. These were wealthy men from oil-rich Venezuela who would come to Miami to have a wonderful time, spending outrageous sums of money on fine food, fine wines, and luxurious resorts. This produced an influx of money in the city and also a big demand for some of the finer things in life. Also, the counterculture phenomenon of the mid-1960s had given birth to a great curiosity and desire to experiment with psychoactive substances. One of the most popular of these substances was marijuana. The use of this substance was not rare in white upper middle class households, most especially college students. For some of the thousands of Cubans exiled in Miami, this was an opportunity. In an attempt to satisfy a massive demand, some began smuggling marijuana into America through Miami. Luther Campbell started selling marijuana, but somewhere along the line, his mother sensed something was off. Uncomfortable with the direction her son's life was heading and wanting him off the streets, she sent him to Washington, D.C. to spend some time with one of his older brothers working in the defense industry. Though the trip to D.C. was short, it had a profound impact on Luke's trajectory and outlook. In his biography, he recounts, "I was sitting up there, seeing black people with suits on, being professionals, riding around in Mercedes. They were running shit, working with computers. It was completely foreign to me. All black people did in Miami was janitor, yard man, bus driver, jobs like that. I didn't see black executives." He returned to Miami after what he says was about 6 months with a renewed zeal and ambition, getting back to his job at the Mount Sinai Medical Center while spinning records in his off time. He even went as far as obtaining an internship at WEDR-FM, later called 99 Jams Radio Station, trying to gain an understanding of how the music business operated. Very soon, the Ghetto Style DJs were growing in fame and influence in Miami, and Campo became a highly sought-after DJ and concert promoter. Luke and the Ghetto Style DJs would usually play reggae, disco, and rock records, manipulating the knobs to maximize the low-end frequencies and belt out impossibly low sounds. The crowds loved it. Luther Campbell didn't stop at modifying other people's music. He introduced his own compositions with the Ghetto Style DJs. One was Ghetto Jump and the other Throw the D. Although Miami was ethnically diverse, most of these outdoor parties being thrown by DJs had an attendance which was predominantly black. Coming out of the civil rights movement, race relations in Miami, particularly amongst blacks and whites, were still a bit shaky. And soon, that shakiness would be exposed. In the early morning hours of December 17, 1979, a group of six police officers stopped a 33-year-old man named Arthur McDuffie, who was riding a black and orange 1973 Kawasaki Z1 motorcycle. It is said that at this time, McDuffie was riding with a suspended license. According to the initial police report, four of the six officers involved in this incident claimed McDuffie had run red lights and stop signs and subsequently led police on an 8-minute high-speed chase. It was then reported that McDuffie attempted to make a left turn, lost control of his vehicle, and according to one of the officers, struck his head on the ground and continued his attempt to flee on foot. When the officers caught up to him, a scuffle broke out in which McDuffie allegedly kicked one of them and resisted arrest. McDuffie was transported to Jackson Memorial Hospital and died only 4 days later, succumbing to his injuries. Given the severity of his injuries, it wasn't long until this story was called into question, and an investigation into the incident began.
This is where the chase ended, and here is where the questions begin. McDuffie crashed his motorcycle, but some of the wounds he sustained are not consistent with the accident.
According to the coroner's report, Arthur McDuffie had suffered multiple skull fractures, including one which was 10 inches long.
What did he die from?
He died as a result of blunt head injuries with destruction of his underlying brain. He was beaten to death.
How hard would someone have to hit someone to inflict such an injury?
Amazingly hard.
In addition to this, it seemed nonsensical that the motorcycle's gauges would be broken after the crash.
Looked at the motorcycle, and I had some background training in accident reconstruction. I know when a motorcycle slides on its side that the pegs that stick out, the rubber pegs where you rest your feet, should have had worn marks on them from coming in contact with the pavement. I didn't find that. I didn't believe that that motorcycle slid on its side.
On December 26, one of the officers, Charles Viverka, made a sworn statement that he had lied in the initial report. According to Viverka's statement, after McDuffie stopped, Viverka pulled him off his motorcycle and McDuffie retaliated by swinging at Viverka. According to Viverka, more officers arrived shortly after and started beating McDuffie with nightsticks and heavy Kel Light flashlights. He added that a patrol car had been driven over the motorcycle to make it look like an accident.
On December 29, 1979, Arthur McDuffie, dressed in his Marine Corps uniform, was buried with full military honors.
The cover-up was investigated and officers received criminal charges. McDuffie was black and all the police officers involved in the incident were not. So the atmosphere in Miami was understandably tense. In fact, so tense that the presiding judge, Lenore Carrero Nesbitt, allowed the trial to be shifted to Tampa. The trial began on March 31st and the lead prosecutor on the case was an attorney called Janet Reno.
On May 17, 1980, the jury gave its verdict.
Campbell published the verdict.
We, the jury at Campbell, Hillsborough County, the 17th day of May, 1980, find the defendant, Alex Marrero, as to second-degree murder, as charged in count one of the information, not guilty. We, the jury at Tampa, Hillsborough County, the 17th day of May, 1980, find the defendant, Ira Diggs, as to manslaughter.
The policemen were cleared of all charges.
Not guilty. So say we all, David H.
The all-white jury acquitted all remaining officers because of inconsistent witness testimony. The black community of Miami were infuriated.
When news of the McDuffie decision reached Miami, black leaders called for a silent protest at the Justice Building here. But those who came were in no mood to be quiet.
We know that we are now at war with the people here that keep pushing us around.
That's right.
We can no longer take it.
That's right.
Calm, because this time we can't take this sitting down. We must take to the streets again like we did in the 60s.
I wanted to believe in the American system. No more. Never again.
The police tried to restrain angry demonstrators outside the Justice Building. Cars were set on fire. More fires were started throughout Overtown and Liberty City. The police couldn't stop the growing fury.
The hospital's emergency room looked like a combat zone. Whites driving through a large black section were pulled from their cars and beaten. A policeman called what happened uncontrolled violence against whites. But blacks attacked blacks, too. This woman's husband had been badly beaten. In all, 113 beating cases were recorded, 13 are in critical condition, and 25 people were shot. Sniping and fighting continued all night. Hardest hit by the violence is a 3-mile-wide and 6-mile-long area called Liberty City. 9 major fires and many smaller ones were set there. Firemen needed armed escorts to try to reach them.
W News also has a report of a building fire in Northwest 54th Street in the city of Miami. But apparently firefighters are having trouble fighting the blaze simply because of violence in that area. We had one report that some fire trucks tried to get in there. They were pelted with stones and bottles.
The total damage at the end of the riots was 18 people killed, 370 people injured, and 787 arrests. Property destruction was well past $100 million, and it became the deadliest city riot in U.S. history until Los Angeles took that title in 1992. A lot in the black community blamed Janet Reno for failing to secure a guilty verdict in the trial, with some even calling for her resignation.
The grassroots organizations in the community have put together a list of demands, Bob. Now, among them, there are 11, and this list is tentative at this time. But let me highlight some of the key demands. First and foremost, the removal of Janet Reno and the investigation of her office. Second, a more equitable manner of jury selection. Third, recruitment and promotion of more black policemen. And finally, amnesty for demonstrators. That would include demonstrators involved in looting, but not those who injured or killed any people.
By 1984, Luther had become a well-established DJ and concert promoter. Until this point, he had been throwing his parties and events at places like the Sunshine Skating Center, and now he was ready to open his own location, the Pat Jam 2. The Pat Jam 2 was a disco club catering to Liberty City teenagers. A grassroots everyday spot where Campbell and others like him were able to both contribute to and draw inspiration from the enthusiastic activities of young dancers. This club may have been the only teen club in the Liberty City neighborhood. It served as a venue for DJs both from within and outside Miami. Also, a new music genre from New York City was taking over the musical preferences of young black audiences in Miami. Hip-hop music is thought to have originated with DJ Kool Herc, a New York DJ who came from Jamaica around his adolescent years. Remembering the sound system culture back in Jamaica, he would isolate the drum breaks of records, loop them, and then start to toast or talk over the new creation.
Perspiration, this a running on me back. John don't say me slimmer, me not go get fatter. The people in the dance, say now them do that. They come, they catch, they kimbo and pose. I take fat John B like a we a one rope, say fi go and go down.
It wasn't long before other DJs in the city adopted these techniques, and one ended up making a mega hit. Afrika Bambaataa's 1982 hit Planet Rock is seen as one of the earliest hip-hop records to blow up on the world stage. On the other side of the nation, a trio of airmen felt inspired by Bambaataa's hit and joined this new musical movement. The Two Live Crew, a Southern California rap group, was formed by three airmen stationed at March Air Reserve Base in Riverside County. The group was composed of Chris Wong Won, a rapper going under the alias Fresh Kid Ice, Yuri Violet, who went by the name Amazing V, and a producer, David Hobbs, more commonly known as Mr. Mix. The idea for the group started around 1982 when David Hobbs, who was stationed in England at the time, first listened to Planet Rock and adored it. Luckily, he got the chance to actually talk to Bambaataa on his European tour and asked him about the kind of equipment he used to make those kinds of sounds. It was at this moment that Bambaataa told him about the Roland TR-808 drum machine. When Hobbs returned to the US, he began to DJ at parties in the barracks at the airbase with some turntables and a brand new 808 drum machine. After meeting Chris Wong Wong and Yuri Vialov, the three men formed the Two Live Crew and held shows on and off base. In 1984, they released a single, The Revelation, through an LA distribution company called McCullough Records.
A revolution of mass confusion, brothers killing each other, robbing their mother, father, sister, and brother. They don't wanna get a job or go to school. They think it's cool, but they're playing the fool.
On the flip side of this single was another of their songs, Two Live. This is the record that found its way in the hands of Loot in Miami.
Listen, party people, let me tell you this. Something I know you can't resist. We came here tonight to let you know that we are the crew gonna steal the show.
Luther Campbell was so impressed that he invited them to come to South Florida and perform at the Pack Jam 2. This may have been a little befuddling for the Two Live Crew because around this time, they weren't really well known even in California. After many successful shows in Miami and their discharge from the army, the group decided to move to Miami. Amazing V dropped out and Mark Ross, a rapper going by the stage name Brother Marquis, joined them. Luther Campbell became their manager, joined the group, and gave them a deal with his own newly formed label, Luke Skywalker Records. Instead of maintaining the socially responsible brand of music that they had started with in California, they began performing Campbell's music, including Ghetto Jump and Throw the D, which weren't too focused on conscious content. From the economic point of view, this decision made sense, as they noticed that songs that were explicit in nature did far better commercially than their more modest creations. For instance, their 1986 debut album, The Two Live Crew Is What We Are, was not entirely a dirty album. But the dirty songs that were on the album, such as We Want Some Pussy and Get It Girl, got the most enthusiastic responses from fans. They took inspiration from some of profane entertainers that preceded them, like Clarence Blowfly Reed.
The girl wants to fuck. You can tell by the way she dances.
Richard Pryor.
See, I know one of the advantages, like when you're in show business, the little extra treat you get is that you get pussy. And no, you know the great pussy drop of the 50s? I was caught up in that motherfucker.
And Rudy Ray Moore, aka Dolomite.
My, what an ass. Always like women with big asses.
Some ass is for need, but this ass is for please.
I see we have another comedian in the house. You still got a lot of ass, mama. I say one thing, if this place would catch on fire and they'd tell everybody to haul ass, you would have to make 10 trips.
They mix this entertainment with Caribbean musical influences, which are renowned for their sexually charged rhythms and dances. In their next album, Move Something, released in 1988, they waded even further into obscenity, and the group's popularity waded further out of obscurity. Although they were now getting famous, not everyone enjoyed this irreverent style of music. When some performers from the birthplace of rap music heard about the musical innovations coming from Miami, they were not too impressed. This led to a lot of tension at shows where both New York performers and Two Live Crew were scheduled to perform. There was a fight between Campbell and Run DMC's manager at a show in Biloxi, Mississippi.
So when you read this book, you'll read about
me having a big fight with Run DMC.
Yeah.
And that's when I made this song, We Want Some P.
Yeah.
That was basically because they were acting like peas. And I made the song, I made that song in Gulfport, Mississippi.
Yeah.
And we was on stage in the middle of a concert, sold out at the arena, and we get ready to go to blows. Because those are the things that happened to us, you know, because we weren't considered hip hop. And it was like everybody was rebelling against us. And I talk about that in the book.
Well, in Memphis, Tennessee, Eric B. and Rakim's handlers told them they could only do 3 minutes at a show there.
We do shows at Eric B. Rakim and actually give us 3 minutes to do a show.
And then in Savannah, Georgia, they had problems with Public Enemy's road manager. To be fair to the New Yorkers, it wasn't just Miami or Southern rappers who were given a hostile reception. NWA and other West Coast rappers also experienced discrimination at the hands of New York artists. Even Schoolie D from nearby Philadelphia had a tough time gaining acceptance from the New Yorkers. And it wasn't just New York rappers who didn't like the attention 2 Live Crew were getting. Around the late 1980s, large parts of the United States were going through what is now referred to as the Satanic Panic. During this time period, large segments of society, particularly law enforcement and therapists, believed there was an extensive underground network of satanic cults sacrificing and abusing children. Satanism and all related subjects became a matter of national interest. Heavy metal rock music, which had a reputation for exploring the occult, came under fire from various parts of society, most especially conservative Christians.
Satan's not stupid. He understands that kids today are visual, and so he's making a play for excitement, for total...
Some of these groups began to take moves to ban certain kinds of entertainment that may be deemed harmful to children, including heavy metal rock music.
Parents should realize that we have explicit and graphic sex, extreme violence, suicide in lyrics, that is going to children that are sometimes not even teenagers yet and young teenagers.
Though the original targets were heavy metal rock stars, somewhere along the line, rappers also got labeled as targets, and 2 Live Crew were found right on the front lines of this battle. In April of 1987 in Callaway, Florida, one store clerk was arrested for selling a copy of the 2 Live Crew Is What We Are to a 14-year-old girl. The clerk was charged with sale of harmful material to a person under the age of 18, a third-degree felony. This resulted in many stores around the area removing the album from their shelves. The group's response was to add a parental advisory sticker on the album. In addition to that, specific instructions were given to every retailer not to sell it to minors, the same kind of restriction a store would put on alcohol and cigarettes. However, this didn't satisfy their opponents. In June of 1988, in a record store called Take Home the Hits in Alexander City, Alabama, a plainclothes cop came in and asked for a copy of Move Something. Well aware of the conservative environment he was working in, the proprietor of the business, Tommy Hammond, kept all such material behind the counter, only available on request. Tommy Hammond sold the album to him and the cop left. Just a little later, the cop returned with a detective and some uniformed officers and arrested Mr. Hammond for selling pornography. This was probably the first time in the recorded history of the United States that a music album qualified as being obscene. Around election time, the attacks on rap music became even more aggressive. Politicians started making speeches on how rap music was corrupting the youth. During the election cycle of 88, Janet Reno decided to run for the position of Dade County State Attorney. While the black community's response to her handling of the McDuffie case should have dented Janet Reno's career, she was actually quite popular come election time. She became especially popular among black women, partly because she helped throw unsupportive fathers in prison for failure to pay child support. Her opponent, Jack Thompson, was a member of the American Family Association, an organization interested in upholding conservative Christian values. This campaign was deeply, deeply acrimonious.
Thompson ran against her while publicly questioning her private life.
I came up with this clever plan of handing her a questionnaire, asking her, you know, are you heterosexual, or are you bisexual, or are you homosexual, and so forth.
She put her arm on your shoulder and said, I'm only attracted to virile men, which is why I'm not attracted to you. And then you filed battery charges against her.
Well, she grabbed a hold of me and shook me. She didn't hurt me, but I was annoyed. I was angry that she dealt with it in that fashion, and that was a mistake. I shouldn't have done that.
Luke Skywalker Records helped Janet Reno in her campaign.
Janet Reno comes to town collecting all the money. You stay one day, then ran away and started acting funny. She brought you down on 15th Avenue, tried to hide your trail. She found your ass and locked you up. Now who can post no bail? What's it?
She won by a landslide. Having lost the election in such an emphatic fashion, Thompson turned his attention to Two Live Crew. He teamed up with Florida Governor Robert Martinez and started to take action against Two Live Crew. In 1989, the Two Live Crew dropped their third album, As Nasty As They Wanna Be. The lead single, Me So Horny, is a catchy anthem built on a sample of a sex worker from Stanley Kubrick's 1987 film, Full Metal Jacket.
Oh, baby, me so horny, me so horny.
You keep lying.
Me love you long time. You pal.
This song shot up to number one on the Billboard Hot Rap Singles chart. In his biography, Luther Campbell admits that the group decided to go all in with the perverseness and make the raunchiest album they could. The group did record a less offensive version of their work, As Clean As They Wanna Be. Predictably, Jack Thompson went after them and found an ally in Broward Sheriff Nick Navarro. Nick Navarro then moved to ban the album in Broward County. Two Live Crew sued Navarro in retaliation around March 1990, challenging the legality of the sheriff's actions. The U.S. District Court for the Southern District of Florida decreed that the album was indeed obscene, meaning anyone selling the album or performing its songs would face prosecution. This led to very interesting shows for the Two Live Crew.
Last night, sang lyrics ruled obscene by a federal judge just 4 days earlier. Authorities then kept their word and arrested two members of the group as they pulled away in their limousine. They are charged with violating Florida's obscenity law and face up to a year in jail if they're convicted.
In Huntsville, Alabama, where the group is to perform this weekend, the city council tightened its obscenity laws last night. The group may face arrest, officials in Huntsville say, if the group's performance includes material ruled obscene by a federal judge in South Florida.
Two Live Crew went on trial in Fort Lauderdale, Florida on Tuesday, charged with singing obscene songs for paying adults during a nightclub performance last June. The jury consisted of five white members, one black. So far, by their own admission, their main problem has been stifling fits of laughter.
Since the obscenity ruling had gone against them, it meant they could no longer perform as many shows as they wanted because some venues wouldn't let them. The ones that did would have police surrounding the venues ready to arrest the performers right after their shows.
Before we get this motherfucking thing started, I want y'all to know one goddamn thing. Is that for the motherfuckers standing on the outside of this motherfucking club talking about paying the $2? You know what they can do for us? They can suck our motherfucking dick.
But 1990 wasn't a year for just Luke to do the suing. First, Nashville music publisher Acuff Rose sued Campbell for using Roy Orbison's Oh Pretty Woman for Two Live Crew's song Pretty Woman off As Clean As They Wanna Be without permission. Campbell did in fact ask for permission and had been denied. Figuring he didn't really need permission to make a parody, he went and used it anyway, but gave Orbson and the co-writer William Dees full writing credits just in case. Then there was MC Shy D, one of the earliest acts signed to Luke Skywalker Records, who was also suing. After netting sales with his first two albums, Got to Be Tough and Coming Correct, Luke claims the label paid him about $95,000 in royalties and then dropped him from their roster. However, MC Shy D claimed that this was insufficient.
I was with Luke to the end of 88, and then I got away. I left the label.
Why'd you leave?
I left because Luke was a crook, man. You know what I mean? He was keeping all the fucking money, man.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, I know you had to go back to get some money later.
We seeing you go from an office like this garage to 500,000 square feet. You know what I'm saying? Seeing.
Y'all watching this.
Yeah, this money. You going into the executive building. You making so much money. You got to go into the executive building. You making so much money. The RS telling you to buy cars, buy a house, or they going to take the money.
Yeah.
We seeing all this, but we only getting show money.
Right.
Which was good money, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But I want that record sale money too.
Right.
Then there was George Lucas, who claimed that the use of the name Luke Skywalker, even with the extra Y, was copyright infringement, and also sued him. Luke paid a settlement with Lucas, went to trial with ACUF, appealed the obscenity verdict, but continued to negotiate with MC Shy D. Jack Thompson and his crew were soon to learn a lesson. Sometimes the quickest way to fame is through the rocky path of controversy. And sometimes the quickest way to get people interested in certain material is to forbid it.
The band album, which had been suffering from declining sales, has been climbing up record charts across the country since the judge's ruling last week.
The banning of As Nasty As They Wanna Be resulted in record sales for the group, insane amounts of fame.
My wife and I are big fans. We love Me So Horny.
It was great, really.
Oh, thanks a lot, thanks a lot.
Now, Eileen's gonna kill me, but she has a great song.
Oh, Richard, no!
Oh, come on, you know it's great. Our friends love it.
Ugh. Okay, I'll do
it. You ready? You ready?
Okay. Face down. That's how I like it. Lap it up. That's the spot.
No.
And increasing public sympathy.
Hi, what's your opinion about Two Live Crew?
They're cool.
Yeah?
Censorship sucks.
Well, that's one way of putting it.
Once you stop letting us saying, hey, you can't do this, you cannot do that, therefore we're going to be Russia.
I feel under the First Amendment they have every right to say what they say, when they want to say it, and how they want to say it.
Okay, let me ask you a question now. What about the other side of the coin, the responsibility to the kids?
The responsibility to the kids is up to their parents. Let their parents decide what they will and will not buy. God did not put us on this earth to have other people throw down opinions on other people's art.
In 1990, the Two Live Crew set about creating a new album, Banned in the USA. This project differed from their earlier ones, being a lot more political in content. The title and the lead single from this new project took inspiration from Bruce Springsteen's Born in the USA.
This is America. We have the right to say what we want to say. We have the right to do what we want to do. And what I do in my house, you might not do in your house. So what I do in my house is my business.
Bruce Springsteen gave the project his blessing, and the album went on to become their highest charting work. In 1991, Sports Weekend, As Nasty As They Wanna Be Part 2 was released. By this time, Two Live Crew were very firmly lodged in the nation's attention and living like rock stars with all the pleasures and excesses that kind of lifestyle provides. In 1992, an attorney by the name of Elena Kagan filed a brief with the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals, in which she argued that As Nasty As They Wanna Be did not physically excite anyone who heard it and had artistic value. This brief helped get the obscenity ruling overturned. When Broward County appealed, the Supreme Court concurred with Kagan and declined to hear Broward County's appeal. This legal battle cost Broward County a reported $100,000 to prosecute and wasn't even that popular. By now, Robert Martinez was no longer governor, having lost to Lawton Childs in 1990, and Nick Navarro also lost his bid for re-election in 1993. With the way now clear, one would have thought that the Two Live Crew should have been flying high off their success. That didn't happen. The rock star lifestyle and the legal battles were beginning to take a toll on the group's finances. Two members of the crew, Brother Marquis and Mr. Mix, claimed that Luke Records owed them money and started to distance themselves from the group. In addition to that, negotiations between MC Shy D and Luke Records had broken down after Luke Records refused to accept the offer Shy D's lawyer had proposed to them, deciding to go to trial instead. Luke Records didn't slow down though. In that same year, Campbell teamed up with a music producer, Fresh McRae, to release I Got Shit on My Mind. In 1993, Luke Records released Houston R&B group H-Town's debut, Fever for the Flavor. By the time 1994 arrived, the copyright infringement case with Akef Rose had gone all the way to the Supreme Court.
This case involves the rap group Two Live Crew and their music company, Luke Records, which recorded and sold a parody of the song Oh Pretty Woman, co-written by Roy Orbison and William Dees. Akef Rose, which owns the rights to Oh Pretty Woman, sued Two Live Crew and Luke Records in U.S. District Court for violating their copyright. The court ruled in favor of Two Live Crew, but the decision was reversed by the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Sixth Circuit. Luther Campbell and other members of Two Live Crew appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court. The case will be heard by the High Court on Tuesday, November 9th.
In the end, the Supreme Court decided that Pretty Woman by Two Live Crew was in fact a parody of Roy Orbison's Oh Pretty Woman and fell under fair use.
Can you play a little bit of both the original version and then also your version?
Let's do Roy first. I got Roy coming up.
Oh, there we go.
That's loud enough for you? Need a little bass? You need no bass?
Pretty woman, walking down the street. Pretty woman, the kind I like to meet. Pretty woman, I don't believe you. You're not the truth. No one could look as good as you.
Now, you want to hear the other one?
You want to hear yours?
You want to hear our version? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, coming in from stage right. Yeah, I think ours better too. It's 1989 version. We had to freshen it up, you know. Street version. This is the street version. See, Roy was the conservative, you know, upper class version. Now we finna play the hood version.
Liberty City.
Liberty City version. See, that's the difference. That's the big deal there. You know, this is, people in the streets can relate to this. So that you gotta keep an open mind when you listen. Here we go.
Not everything went Campbell's way in this year, though. Around October 1994, after nearly 4 years of contention, the courts ruled that Luke Records should pay MC Shy D a grand total of $2.3 million. Now, although some of the albums on the label were doing well, this sum of money was too much for Luke Records to dish out. By this time, Mr. Mix was producing different albums, Brother Marquis was in Atlanta and had formed the group Too Nasty with producer DJ Toom. Fresh Kid Ice had remained with Luke Records and tried forming another incarnation of the Two Live Crew with Miami rapper Verb and Luther Campbell. He even had his own solo album, The Chinaman, released by Luke Records. Campbell was forced into bankruptcy in 1995, and MC Shy D's lawyer, Richard Wolf, became the liquidating trustee of Luke Records. His task was to oversee the dissolution of the company's assets. As if that was not enough, Luke's own lawyer, Joseph Weinberger, now claimed that Luke also owed him money. Joseph Weinberger set up a record label, Lil Joe Records. He went ahead and purchased most of the Luke Records catalog in 1996, including that of the Two Live Crew, for what is reported to be only $800,000.
You were sued by Two Live Crew members and MC Shy D. The judge awarded Shy D $1.2 million and said he was making an example out of you.
Well, the interesting thing about that case there, that was the case that started basically everything. Joe Weinberger at the current time was my in-house attorney. He hired an attorney named Nick Manzini that followed his timeline. Nick Manzini was representing me. Joe Weinberger later on, at the time I found that he was a classmate of Richard Wolf at the University of Miami. Him and Richard Wolf was classmates. In my opinion, they conspired to do this against my company. Later on, to find that, and this is the case of MC Shy D, an individual who had never sold over 50,000 records. You can go check the record books right now today. If you go to the manufacturer, which it was a cut and dry case, you go to the manufacturer, which is Caribbean Manufacturers, here in South Florida, and you will find that he's never sold over 50,000 records. I've never manufactured over 50,000 records for this individual, so I'm thinking it's a cut and dry case. But if you have my lawyer, my in-house lawyer, working with the other lawyer, not providing my current lawyer the information, as well as hiring an incompetent lawyer in Nick Manzini, in my opinion, because later on, after I went bankruptcy, the trustees, which was Richard Wolf and Frank Terzo, as well as Joe Weinberger, ended up suing Nick Manzini for his incompetency in the case, winning a large sum of money for misrepresenting me. So it goes to show the conspiracy theory was not actually a theory, it was actually a fact.
Conspiracy? You decide. But a great purchase nonetheless. All the members of the Two Live Crew, except Luke, signed a deal with Lil Joe Records. They put out one album, Shake a Little Something, in 1996, before things started to turn sour there as well.
The court gave us all back the name. So this is where it gets a little, this is where the fuckery comes in. They gave us all back the name. Me and Mr. Mix was in the studio doing the Shake a Little Something album, and the day that the judge granted the bankruptcy went into motion. The judge told Chinaman and Mr. Weinberger that all three of us have the name, but for some odd reason, I don't know if it was money, greed, or whatever, Chinaman sold some of the name, thinking he sold some of the name to Mr. Weinberger, but in the middle of all of that, Mr. Weinberger had some fraudulent paperwork or whatever. Something happened to where he ended up owning the name. So me and Mr. Mix, at that time, me and Mr. Mix didn't even know that we could have had the name. You know what I mean? Because we were making records, you know, all three of us as a group. But Chinaman knew that, and he went behind our back and sold the name to Weinberger, and then Weinberger fucked him out of the name.
Right.
Right, basically.
Mr. Mix left, and Brother Marquis and Fresh Kid Ice released what would be 2 Live Crew's last album, The Real One, in 1998. After that, Brother Marquis decided to leave the label as well, marking the complete dissolution of the group. Brother Marquis continued to release music, including an album, Bottom Boy Style, under Playalistic Entertainment in 2003. Mr. Mix and Fresh Kid Ice started their own labels, released a few albums as well. And Luke, he continued with music, but also got involved in other forms of entertainment, such as movies, video games.
I got something to say to all other radio stations.
No matter how hard you try, you can't stop us now.
It's my boys from New York City, African Bombada, Renegades and Funk. Right here on Fresh 105, baby.
Fresh 105.
And adult films. While various incarnations of the group did reunite in the following years, no new albums were ever released. Unfortunately, in July of 2017, Fresh Kid Ice passed away in Miami, marking the first passing of one of the legendary group's founding members. Looking back at this story, it is not far-fetched to say that 2 Live Crew played a leading role in the defense of free speech for musicians. While you may not be a fan of the group's music, you do have to acknowledge the incredible impact that this group had on the hip-hop genre in particular and on popular culture as a whole.
Yeah, I mean, it's a big deal. Mm-hmm. It's a big deal. I mean, the way YouTube works these days with people doing parody videos, if you guys didn't have that, it would just be lawsuit after lawsuit after takedown after takedown. Yeah,
exactly.
Your record label informs you that you're about to have a case or...
Hold on.
Okay.
Time out. Mm-hmm. Record label inform me.
He's the record label.
Mm. No, I own the shit.
My bad, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was...
He literally pressed this one right here. The first black label. That alone we got to get back to, because I want a segment on that alone.
You know that, you know, I'm the one who created Southern Hip Hop. They don't know I... went to the Supreme Court for hip hop. They don't know I was the first person to have a record banned, deemed obscene by a federal judge. And if I did not fight and win that case, then rappers right now today wouldn't be able to say the things that they say on the record without going to jail or getting their record taken off the shelf. And people just need to know that, you know.
Thank you for watching.